Welcome to the lecture 6. In the previous class, we discussed the application of electrochemical kinetic concepts to corrosion. The basis for application of the electrochemical concepts to corrosion is the mixed potential theory, right? The mixed potential theory is the basis. Okay, for application of electrochemical concepts. Corrosion. And the mixed potential theory talks about freely corroding material, freely corroding, say I call it as a metal. When I say freely corroding, no external current, no external potential is applied on the metal. You just immerse it and let it corrode, and in that condition, whatever corrosion rate that occurs, given by corrosion current density and the corresponding corrosion potential, they are all dictated by the mixed potential theory. So, in the freely corroding material, essentially what happens, I oxidation is equal to I reduction. When I say I oxidation means there can be more than one reaction of oxidation, there can be more than one reactions of reduction process. So, the total oxidation is equal to total reduction rate. So, that is the mixed potential theory. We discussed this yesterday using a metal with an oxidizer, wherein we said that if you talk about a metal, go back to your notes and see that now we have two independent equilibria in a corrosion system, right. So, you represent two independent equilibria in the system. For a metal, you have an equilibrium potentials and you also have, what do you call this, exchange current density, right, you have this. And the other equilibrium that we talk about, let us say something like maybe hydrogen evolution reaction, whatever we can talk about. Now, you have I naught H plus H on the metal that we are talking about is happening, and this is what? This is E equilibrium potential of H plus H, this is what? The equilibrium potential of what? It is metal N plus and M. So, we said that they independently polarize following its own Tafel kinetics. This is the Tafel kinetics for oxidation, the Tafel kinetics for the reduction process. Okay, let us say M going as M N plus plus N electrons. And in this case, you can say M going as M N plus plus an electron. Similarly, you can write for the hydrogen as H plus, sorry, This is H going as H plus plus electron oxidation, and you have reduction process corresponds to H plus plus electron gives rise to half hydrogen. And you find at only one place, that is the rate of oxidation is equal to rate of reduction, and corresponding to that potential we call them as E car. So, we are talking about the application of the electrochemical parameters such as I naught, equilibrium potentials, the Tafel slopes that we have here, okay. How they govern the E chord and the I chord values. In the last class, we also saw two examples of iron and zinc, and we said that in an acid solution, zinc will corrode at a lower rate compared to iron, right. The reason was, what was the reason for that? The exchange condensity is different, okay. The exchange condensity in this case differs very significantly, and so despite zinc having a relatively negative equilibrium potential, it will show a lower corrosion rate compared to iron. The reason was the exchange condensity we saw in the last class. I hope you have seen the notes. Let us move further in understanding the corrosion of metals. Now, we look at the role of an oxidizer. Let me give you the picture. I take a beaker and I take, let us say, hydrochloric acid, take that, and I immerse an iron piece. Now, assuming that they are in the standard state, okay, iron is in equilibrium with, let us say, Fe2 plus of unit activity, and the hydrogen gas here is equal to one atmosphere, okay. It is possible for you to calculate the corrosion rate. Right, if you are given exchange condensity, Tafel slopes, you can compute the equilibrium potential, all you can do that, right. Can you graphically as well as solving equation, can you find out I chord value in this? Can you or can you not? Is it possible or not? Yeah, I want a clear response. I just take iron piece and put it in hydrochloric acid, and I say that activity of Fe2 plus here is unit activity, and I also say that the hydrochloric acid is of unit activity, the partial pressure of hydrogen is equal to 1 atmosphere, and I will give you exchange condensity values, I give you a Tafel slope. Is it possible for you to determine the E car and I car? Is it possible or not? Yes, okay. Now, what I am going to do is, and to this I am going to add ferric ions. Added to this. And the ferric ion concentration, the activity of Fe3 plus can be considered as unity. Now, I need to know what happens to the corrosion rate of iron, and I would like to calculate what is the corresponding corrosion potentials, right. So, we need to calculate ICOR in HCl plus what? Plus precursor solutions. I need to calculate ICOR in HCl plus free cations additions here. Is it possible to calculate, or can you able to visualize how to get this based on what is called as the mixed potential theory, right? Now, how to proceed? What to proceed here? How to proceed here? First of all, you need to identify the equilibrium first. How many equilibria are present in this system, right? So, without, let us say, without the addition of, say, ferric ion means I add ferric chloride. Without the addition of ferric chloride, what is the equilibrium we will have? Start with, yeah, one will be H plus plus electron gives you hydrogen. What will be the other equilibria? Fe2 plus 2 electron gives you Fe. Now, for this I can calculate E if I know the activity of the ions. I can also know, maybe experimentally otherwise, the exchange current density of what? Fe2 plus Fe, and here H plus H on ion, right. So, now I can able to first of all determine the corrosion rate of iron in hydrochloric acid. Can I do this graphically with the Evans diagram? So, how to do that? Can you please try yourself first? Given the Tafel slopes, right, you just draw the Evans diagram so that you can obtain ICOR and ICOR, right. You assume a standard state, okay. The standard state here, you can assume E equals to E naught. You can also assume exchange current density of H plus H is equal to exchange current density of ion 2 plus ion is equal to 10 power minus 6 ampere centimeter square. And you can also assume that beta or equal, for assumption, this is equal to, you can assume let us say about 100 millivolts. You can compute, right. Can you draw it yourself and get ICOR and ICOR values? Suppose you have drawn a similar diagram like this, okay. So, what is the additional equilibrium now I have? Suppose I add to this ferric ions, I would have another equilibria, Fe3 plus plus electron gives me Fe2 plus, right. Would I have this or not? When I add ferric chloride to this solution, I already have Fe2 plus ions. It can establish one more equilibrium, which is Fe3 plus plus electron giving you Fe2 plus, right. I have given you a handout. If you take the handout there and see what is the corresponding standard potential for this, yeah, it is E0 for this is equal to plus 0.771 watt, right. So, what I do? I represent the same equilibrium, I mean in the same diagram. I represent this equilibrium in this diagram. So, represent the diagram equilibrium there. Can you put this in here? So, the value comes somewhere here. And of course, I can have a diagram going like this. What does this one correspond to? What will be this line correspond to? What reaction? Reduction, right? This will be 3 plus plus electron gives you 2 plus, correct? And what will be this one? This will be Fe 2 plus going as Fe plus electron here, and this corresponds to your exchange current density and you have. Now, there are three equilibria in the system, 1, 2 and 3 having different equilibrium potentials and maybe different exchange current densities. You can also use the different Tafel slopes you want, it is not necessarily the same slope, it is easier to operate here. So, I have assumed the Tafel slopes are going to be same, it is not necessary at all. Now, what does the mixed potential theory say? It says the total amount of oxidation is equal to total amount of reduction now. So, what I do now? I need to find out what are the corresponding oxidation reactions and the reduction reactions now. Let us take this, let us take the now let us take, let us start from here. At any given potential, this is the reduction reaction, reduction. When you cross this potential, please notice, let us say you are going somewhere here. Suppose you are coming to this particular potentials. The total amount of cathodic reaction is given by the summation of this current and this current. If I take this metal and hold this metal at this particular potential, what are the reaction will occur? Reduction of hydrogen gas, I mean hydrogen ions into gas, and reduction of Fe3 plus into Fe2 plus. Both will happen on this metal surface when you start moving below these potentials. So, the total current will be is equal to sum of these currents, right. And when you cross this potential, how many reduction reactions will occur? Below this potential, how many reduction reactions will occur? 3, right? So you have one more current adding to this. Is understood? So this corresponds to what? This corresponds to I of what? I of Fe3 plus to Fe2 plus plus I of H plus to hydrogen plus I of Fe2 plus to Fe. Yeah.
Have all the three reaction taken part simultaneously with the same driving force? Since Fe3 plus to Fe2 plus have high potential and are also nobler than H plus to H2, what will happen in every cases?
Yeah, so we are coming to that. Okay, we are coming to that. We are coming to what will happen to Fe3 plus, Fe2 plus, hydrogen gas evolution. That's what we are going to arriving at actually. So this is one step towards learning what would happen ultimately. You got it? We are reaching that point, but we are trying to go step by step to show how that point is reached, so that you have clarity in terms of the electrochemical kinetics. I hope this question is clear, and I hope you are clear as to what we are doing. We are simply trying to relate the current versus potential if you have multiple reactions actually, right. So please notice every case the equilibrium will behave its own manner. This one, this is not going to change, this is not going to change, nor this is going to change. But what will happen is the total amount of reaction that are occurring are going to be changing depending upon the potentials. You got it or not? Okay. So you find that the number of reactions that will happen will increase, it becomes 2 here, it becomes 3 here. Similarly, you can also consider what will happen to the anodic reaction, right. Let us look at the anodic reaction. This you can extrapolate this. You can extrapolate this. Where will the anodic reaction start increasing? It will start increasing at this point. Got it? So you will find the anodic reaction for this is going to be this. So what is this one corresponds to? This corresponds to both I corresponds to I E Fe going as Fe2 plus plus 2 electron plus what? I H going as H plus plus electrons. Am I right? Correct or not correct? If I go to this potential, if I cross somewhere here, suppose I draw a line here, and beyond this point, what happens? You have one more what reaction? Oxidation reaction takes place. So it's very simple way of putting things here. Now look at this diagram. There's only one place the mixed potential theory is valid. Tell me where it is. All other places the mixed potential theory is not valid. For the mixed potential theory to be valid, the rate of oxidation is equal to reduction. I mean total oxidation rate is equal to total reduction rate. So tell me where in this diagram the mixed potential theory is applied. Can you tell me that? you have red color and you have blue color and you have black color. Yeah, red color intersecting with the black line here. Okay, so only here you find the mixed potential theory is valid here only. In all other places, if you just hold, you know, at any given, suppose you take this potential here, right? What happens? The rate of oxidation is more than the rate of reduction. All happen here. Only here, the rate of oxidation is equal to rate of reduction. So that is going to be your changed what? Change I car values. So this is going to be your icar, hydrochloric acid and HCl added, and icar HCl plus Fe3 plus. I hope you are not simply taking down the notes. I hope you are following whatever I am discussing here. We are simply applying the mixed potential theory, right? And any given potential you find out, you take any potential you want, right? Maybe you take this particular potential, you find out what are the reactions are occurring. There is only one reaction occurring here, so there is only one current. No, yeah, what anode current is concerned, only one current, but you have how many? You have two cathodic currents here, so sum it up. Okay, so you just have to find out at any given potential how many reactions are occurring and add up that current, that gives you total current, total anodic current and total cathodic current, or the total oxidation current and total reduction current, right? Are you clear about this? Can I move? So I am going to read all this for your clarity so that we can understand this diagram a bit better. Let me draw only the relevant portion of the Evans diagram. This corresponds to hydrogen. Okay. Drawn this diagram. This is your icar in the absence of ferric chloride, so icar. Okay. Let me now tell you what happens. Let us visualize this diagram again. We have a beaker, hydrochloric acid, and you have put the steel here. Put the iron for simplicity, okay. If I measure the E curve of this, that corresponds to this one, am I right? If you can know the I curve of that should correspond to this. Agreed? Now, the rate of hydrogen evolution on the surface, please notice the rate of hydrogen evolution on the surface is given by this point. Corresponding to this current, the hydrogen evolution occurs. The same point also corresponds to the high resolution of the metal, right. If ferric chloride is added, if add ferric chloride to this, okay. So, what do you observe on the metal surface? Will there be increase in hydrogen evolution, decrease in hydrogen evolution, increase in the corrosion current or decrease in the corrosion current, increase in the E curve or decrease in the E curve? Please note down, I would like to know the following. What happens to the hydrogen evolution rate on the metal surface? What happens to the E curve? What happens to I curve? Now, let us go to the question number 1. What will happen to hydrogen evolution on the metal surface? Can you look at the diagram and tell? Please look at the diagram. You know what is the corresponding E curve, right? What is the corresponding E curve for that? Will the E curve remain the same when I add ferric chloride solution to this? What will happen to E curve? So, the potential move off. So, then what happens? Then what will happen to hydrogen evolution? Please see there. No, please look at the diagram. It decreases, right? At this particular potential, the hydrogen evolution on the metal surface is decreases. It is decreases from where? It decreases from the hydrogen evolution rate is decreasing. What happens to corrosion rate? Is it decreasing? No, it is increasing, right? The corrosion rate is increasing, okay. So, please follow the diagram, okay. If you follow the diagram, you would not go wrong. Why does it decrease? It decreases because the over voltage for hydrogen evolution reaction. What is the over voltage for hydrogen evolution reaction in this case? How do you find out? Without ferric chloride, this is my E curve, right? Can I find out the over voltage for hydrogen evolution? What is the over voltage? Equals to E curve minus E naught, E apply, E equilibrium, right. Now, when you applied, when you add ferric chloride, what is happening to over voltage? It is decreasing. So, the hydrogen evolution reaction rate has to be decreasing, it should be consistent. Then, I increase the corrosion rate of iron, hydrogen evolution is decreasing. How is possible? Because the ferric ions are getting reduced to ferrous ions. The electrons are now taken by other species to look at it actually here. Of course, law of conservation of charges have to be there. It cannot happen. You cannot increase the corrosion rate and there is no corresponding cathodic reaction to what happened. It only says the hydrogen evolution rate is decreasing, but the Fe3 plus to Fe2 plus is increasing. It is going to increase from here to this. The water voltage for that is increasing from here to this is happening at all, right. So, that is the important thing you should understand in the electrochemical concepts, ok. Any questions here? Is it looking confusion? Ok. So, this is an important and also the most, one of the most difficult events diagrams that you can think of, ok. You will see one more complex events diagram later, but this is one of the most complex events diagram. It is very simple. What have you done here? When I said corrosion, I identified what are the possible equilibria, right. You started from there. So, identify the equilibria, right. You identify the equilibria first of all. If you identify the equilibria, then you should have electrochemical parameters for that. Equilibrium potentials, exchange current density, travel slopes, all the required. Use that parameters to draw events diagram. If there are more than one oxidation or more than one reduction equilibria possible, represent them in the events diagram. Follow the mixed potential theory. What does it mean? You can also find out any given potential, what is the total amount of oxidation and what is the total amount of reduction, right. You construct events diagram for that. And then at one point, you will see that the mixed potential theory is valid, wherein the rate of total oxidation is equal to the rate of total reduction. So, that is a place the metal will corrode, and that is a corrosion rate, that will be the corrosion potentials. So, it is a very simple concept. It is only thing is you need to go systematically to get this particular E car value and I car values. Let me go further into the system. Let me take another example of corrosion. Of metal, say in seawater. It's an example. It's only an example here. What does seawater consist of? Salt solution, NaCl solution. What is the cathodic reaction here? Predominant cathodic reaction, it has got what oxygen? It has got water. Suppose I take a metal, say I am having a metal immersed. So, the picture is that I have a sea water. And I am immersing a metal in this. Why did I take seawater? What is the cathodic reaction here in this case? What is the likely cathodic reaction in this case? Anybody recollect? The cathodic reaction here is oxygen plus what is the anodic reaction? You can say M going as M electron. This is your cathodic, your anodic reaction, right. Oh, I am sorry. This is the cathodic. And this is anodic reaction. Why did I give this system? Because we remember that we talked about oxygen reduction reaction is diffusion control, right? So when it is diffusion control, we will see how the corrosion rate changes, or what are the factors that control the corrosion rate of metal when the system is under diffusion control, okay. Before I go into that, it is very interesting to see, we talk of sodium chloride here, sodium chloride does not figure out anywhere here. Can sodium chloride directly take part in corrosion process, in oxidation reduction? Can it take place? It cannot take place. Chloride cannot take an electron. Sodium ions are, you know, they are so electro negative, it cannot happen. So NaCl directly does not take part in the corrosion process. We will see later how the sodium chloride affects the corrosion. You wait for some time, it is indirectly affecting the corrosion process. No electrochemical reactions are possible with sodium chloride dissolved in water. Neither it can take electron nor it can accept electron, okay, because of the electrochemical potential this particular equilibrium will have. Let us come to this. Now, what is a diffusion control process, okay? How do I represent this? I have two equilibrium, one for oxygen, other for the metal. Okay, for a metal, oxygen that I have here. This is activation control here. And what is this? This is diffusion control. And you can also know what is the equilibrium potential, exchange current density, equilibrium potential for that, exchange current density for this, all you can represent in the Evans diagram. What does ICOR depend on? What is this current called, by the way? What is this current called? IL, right? This is called as IL, is called as limiting current density. So, ICOR depends on what? Depends upon the diffusion current density or limiting current density IL. For argument's sake, if I change a metal, another metal N, let us say, with this is, let us say, N going as N. Some is N plus only, plus N electron, plus electron gives you that, okay. So, what happens? This is the other metal. So, what happens here? It has got a different equilibrium potentials, it may have a different exchange current density, what happens to corrosion rate? What do you see? So, limiting current, so the corrosion rate does not change as long as the corrosion is controlled by, you know, diffusion process. That is the cathodic reaction here. So, you may have a relatively noble metal, relatively active metal. For example, I take stainless steel, I take nickel, carbon steel, may all corrode at the same rate if it is a diffusion controlled corrosion process. Can I make this statement? Is it correct? Not correct. I would respond, is it correct or not correct? You have any conviction or not? No? What will happen now? Please tell me, in this case, if I change the equilibrium potential of the metal or exchange current density, if I change, will the corrosion rate of the metal change or not? It won't change. Okay. So, it won't change, you don't see that things are happening at all. Okay. So, this is what is important, and this is we call them as diffusion control process. Okay. We have seen so far the metals which are actively corroding. There are some metals, they show passivity. Okay. So, we should understand the concept of passivity. And it was Michael Faraday, I suppose all of you know him, right? He did it in 1840, he did some nice experiments, okay, to show that the metals undergo passivity. All of us know about that, I think. I do not think that any of you guys were not aware of passivity. You know, stainless steel and the carbon steel, the difference is in the corrosion rate, and that corrosion rate is achieved because of stainless steels showing passivity. So, let us try to understand systematically what is mean by passivity. Passivity means the reactivity comes down, reactivity falls. That means the corrosion rate of the metal drops under certain circumstances. Under certain circumstances. So, that we should know how, what kind of circumstances are we talking about. He did some nice experiments, Michael Faraday. You people know that nitric acid, right, it is a very highly oxidizing acid. What he did was, he took a beaker and he filled that with concentrated HNO3 and it dropped a steel piece. Not highly oxidizing solution, it should corrode very heavily. Okay. Observed no corrosion. No no, I don't say no corrosion, I may say no absorbable corrosion, okay. No observable corrosion rate. Can't see that. Surface looks reasonably, uncorroded, somewhat shiny, you can say. Then he did another experiment. He took, in this case, dilute nitric acid. Steel, you found lot of hydrogen gas coming. So, there are hydrogen evolution. So, you see corrosion process. Corrosion is visible. Then is wondering what is happening at all. He made a scratch here. He took a glass rod, he made a scratch here like that, okay. Then he found corrosion occurred, but again stopped. It stopped. Then he did another experiment, okay, wherein you have beaker, dilute nitric acid, you put a steel here, steel from test 1, this is test 1, test 2 and test 3, okay. And you transferred this one, okay, that means you transferred sample here for no corrosion, no observable corrosion. Then you made a scratch. Corrosion occurred. So, when there is a scratch here, we had a scratch here, the corrosion start occurring, lot of hydrogen starts evolving from that. When you made a scratch here, it did not happen. Corrosion occurred, but again stopped. In this case, it is happening. In this case, it is continues to happen from the beginning. So, he concluded that film forms. Film forms in test 1, they called as passive film. So, that was an experiment, and you showed that steel will corrode less in concentrated nitric acid, will corrode more the dilute nitric acid. That is a little unusual, right? When you increase the oxidizer concentration, the corrosion rate should increase only, but does not happen. So, you call this as a passivity. Now, passivity is a big subject, and I will just give you a brief account of that. You form a film. Passive films, or barriers. Barriers for what? Barriers for corrosion. They form an electrical barrier for corrosion, right? It has happened. And these films, it's about 30 to 100 angstrom thick. You know what angstrom is? It is 10^10 meter. I said 10^10 angstrom is equal to 1 meter. Now, what does this passivity really means? What does it mean from electrochemical point of view? What happens? Now, I consider a metal in a solution. And I apply this potential. I apply eta is equal to negative, so positive. If I apply a positive eta, what is eta? It's a water voltage. Now I follow the current, and you will see so I start with an equilibrium potential. And I have a corresponding exchange current density, right? This is the equilibrium potential for the metal here. When I apply a over voltage, which is positive, what will happen to current? Current is supposed to increase like that. And this behavior is called what? What relation does it follow here? Taffel relation, right? It is a Taffelian behavior. It increases. After some time, the current drops. Then again, it goes like that. Again, goes like this. See, there is an active dissolution, the dissolution rate decreases, and what happens here? Here it is a passivation, call it. Then again, what happens here? Here again, dissolution, this is called as transpassive dissolution or we will see later, it is also called as pitting. The metal undergoes active, passive, transpassive transition, right? As a transition, active, passive, transpassive transitions. This is how the current is moving. This is a schematic of a metal exhibiting passivity. As you rise the potential, you see the driving force for corrosion increases, but then again decreases. Again increases, and this metal is supposed to be showing active, passive, transpassive transitions. They are all very important for us. Most of the engineering metals, you want to make them corrosion resistant, one way to do is to make them passive. Or you want to reduce the corrosion rate, you have to go for a noble metal. Noble metal is not possible. You can't use copper, you can't use silver, you can't use gold. But if the metal can show passivity, then they are very good. Such metals are what? Like stainless steels and alloy, titanium, chromium, some of these metals and alloys are very much useful because they exhibit passivity. Now, for us, from this diagram, we need to know how, from this diagram, we understand the corrosion of the passive metals. Before we go this, I would like to, you know, tell you what are these parameters really mean. This is the maximum current the metal reaches, right, when you polarize anodically, and this current density is called as I critical current density. The maximum current beyond which the metal starts passivating. And this current density is called as IP, passivation current density. And this potential above which the metal starts passivating, and this potential is called as passivation potentials. We can use P as passivation potential. And this potential, what you see here, where the current steeply increases, this potential corresponding to this is called as pitting potential. Are also called as E, transpassive potentials. Now let us look at the behavior of this active, passive, transpassive transition, how it changes. It would change depending upon the metal, depending upon the environment, right. So, passivation behavior. Suppose I take a metal that exhibits passivation. Let us say I am getting this passivation in sulfuric acid. The concentration of sulfuric acid here is, let us say, 0.01 molar sulfuric acid. If I increase the concentration, If I increase it further, so if I can change the concentration of the environment, the passivation characteristic change. You know, what are the characteristics? The critical condensity, passivation condensity, the transpassive potentials, things will change. This could change other, like even temperatures. You can also have, let us say, chloride. Suppose I have chlorides, could change. In essence, the passivation characteristics depend upon what? Depend upon the metal and the environment. They decide what? They decide IP, EP and EPIT are also called as the transpassive potentials, and you can also change your condensity. So, the metal and the environment, okay, can influence these parameters. They are not unique, you know, kinetic parameters. Now, let us go to the next question for us. In such a case, what decides the corrosion rate? What decides the corrosion rate in the system? Follow the same principle, right? So, you know that the metal is passivating, right? This is an anodic reaction. Maybe let us say you have a metal going as Mn plus plus an electron. This may be your cathodic reaction for that. This is your I naught M plus, M N plus, right? M N plus M. This is the equilibrium potential. How do you get corrosion rate for this? What do you need for that? You need a cathodic reaction. So, what is the corresponding cathodic reaction? If the corresponding cathodic reaction is represented, I can get the corrosion rate. Assume that the cathodic reaction follows this. Assume that I have a cathodic reaction, it follows this. Assume that I have a cathodic reaction, follows this. Of course, I can ask a cathodic reaction somewhere here. You can imagine, I mean, you have no restrictions about that, okay. Now, you can have a cathodic reaction of this kind, this kind, this kind, this kind. All are possible. Then for you now to determine ECAR and ICAR is not a difficult. What is the criteria for identifying ECAR and ICAR? What is the criteria? Mixed potential theory, the rate of the total oxidation rate of the reaction is equal to the rate of the total reduction rate of the system. If it is if it is governing, you get E car and I car. It is as simple as that. What would be the nature of the anodic curve and cathodic curve? That is the criteria for you to determine E car and I car values. Okay. So, we will see this in the next class, how you can determine these values and how such diagrams are useful in real life situations. Okay. So, I stop here.